for issues that we think are of a lot of importance. When your children, your young, I call them children, but everybody, your adolescents and young people are going through a critical time in their lives. I'm not going to talk very long. I just want to introduce Dr. Stan Kutcher. He's with the IWK. I asked him what title that I should give him. He said, well, which one do you want? And I said, well, whichever is your favorite. He said, father. No, make that grandfather. I discovered talking to Stan that he and I walked different parts of Manitoba at different times. If he decides to tell you Manitoba stories, some of them are pretty good. In any case, I won't delay any longer. I'd just like to welcome Dr. Kutcher and express our appreciation as a community for him giving up his free time to help spread around the information that he has for us. Thank you.
Great. Thanks an awful lot. It's delightful to be here. It's a real pleasure to be here, actually. At my age, it's a pleasure to be anyway. The time that we have is identified as adolescent mental health and suicide of the topics. Is this the right audience?
Okay.
So one of the things about having someone come in to speak is there may be things that they will say that might be of interest to you, but there may be a whole bunch of things that they say that actually will be of no interest to you.
Right.
So in order that we could try to mitigate the possibilities of the latter, why don't you tell me what you think that broad area you'd like to address? So this part of the evening is yours. You have 32 seconds. Raise your hand, and we'll take 5 or 6 suggestions, and then we'll work from there.
Hi. I'd be interested in your take.
So much anxiety. So one of the things that we'll do is we'll try to figure out what that word actually means, because there's a lot of confusion about that. Anything else? Yes.
I guess further to that, when do you know when you need to reach out to get help? If anxiety is getting to a level of trying to get help, then how do you ask to do that?
Okay. So how do you differentiate anxiety, whatever word that is? From the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, and when you should move back. Yeah.
OCD.
How to help someone with obsessive compulsive disorder? Okay.
Cutting. Share with you not just theoretical but actual. Been there, got the scars. They would say the same thing, but you know, it's quite Aaron, they did fine after all. There and then there.
I'm going to touch on the role of media or the influence of media on teenage.
Influence of media. Do you mean formal media? Do you mean electronic media? Do you mean social media? Do you mean?
I think kids these days lump it all together. They don't see them as their separate.
Okay, that's tough because CNN and the idiot with two thumbs and two different things. Sometimes they're not quite so different.
see five letters.
I didn't have television, so. Okay.
Isolation, teenagers who are experiencing isolation, whether it be physical or emotional, and how to help them get through that.
Okay, so we've done a lot of different things to try and cover. So I'm going to try to start to address components of that and try to bring in the different pieces, all right? Before we go on, any other burning issues that we can try to address? Yes?
Just like one size, which can be more things like suicide,
okay, one of the signs you need to be looking for, that was a question about how do we know if we can go for help and all those together. Okay, well, great. We've got 6 hours together, so we'll try to cover half of those topics. Well, maybe what I can do is start out by doing two things. One is telling you that when you go home this evening, our website is called teenmentalhealth.org. www.teenmentalhealth.org. If you just type in teen mental health into Google, our website will be the first non-commercial ad, because we don't have ads for our website. So there's a ton of information that you can find on it, and everything is all sorts of downloadable materials that are all free of charge. You just help yourself to anything. So why don't I start out first with a little bit of clarity about the language that we use, okay? So if we take every single person that is in this room and you take your life over pretty well any 24-hour period, we will all experience a phenomenon that we call distress. And I all know what that is. I'm late for work, I didn't do my homework, you know, my mother caught me sneaking something into the house that I shouldn't be sneaking into the house. My wife realized that I was eating chocolate chunkies, you know, all those different things. So that is a distress response, and that means, and this is where some of the anxiety stuff comes in, our bodies have built-in stress response. And I'll talk about that in more detail in a minute. Its purpose is to tell you that something's not right and that you have to make some kind of change. So it is adaptive. It drives our adaptation. And that's that familiar stuff that you feel, a little stress response. It's normal. It's ubiquitous, which means everybody has it. It's very common. It's almost impossible for a human being to go through a day without having it. And it's necessary. Without it, we don't learn. It's the foundation of learning new things. We play with that distress response at our peril. I'm going to come back to what that means. So, briefly, it means we have to let ourselves, teenagers, the young people, their parents, experience that stress response. Because otherwise, they don't learn. They have to adapt to something. And it's experiencing that stress response, and this is really important, figuring out the solution to what's causing the problem that leads to resilience, adaptation, growth, and development. Absolutely essential. And one of the problems that we're seeing now in our schools and in our societies is an infatuation with teaching kids that the stress response is bad for them. It's not. It's good for them. And so a lot of kids are avoiding having the stress response, or spending their time mitigating it, trying to decrease its intensity. The trouble with that is the more that you avoid a normal stress response,
less stressed. And then the next time, you're way more stressed. And pretty soon, what you have is you have debilitating stress, when what you started out with was just normal little bits of stress. And so if always, over and over and over again, you don't face the problem that's causing the difficulty, you end up never being able to face the problem that's causing the difficulty. And that's a huge challenge. And one of the things that makes it difficult is that there is an entire industry which is willing to sell you stuff. And they promise, what do they promise to this industry that sells you stuff? Who's got an iPhone? Okay. All right, nice to see you. Could you, someone, Google in, go to Professor Google, write stress-free, and then think of any other noun that you want to put in, and what do you get? You've got an iPhone or an Android. What do you got? Can you share with us what you find? You sound only one person. I love these teenagers. Where you guys got no phones? Come on. Stress-free life. Yeah. Could there ever be such a thing as a stress-free life? Can someone Google stress-free life? Is there something in there? Yeah, what is it? What is it?
10 simple ways.
Oh, 10 simple ways. Could you need out at least one or two of them so we can all be elucidated? Yeah. What happens there
is we call that stress, absolutely, but it's tolerable stress. It means it's going to hurt. It means you're going to have a lot of negative emotions, negative cognitions, and they make it difficult for us to go to school, do our jobs. But we get through it. Because human beings always have got through it. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. And the things that help us get through tolerable stress are what? What kind of things help us?
Friends.
Friends, absolutely. What else?
Family.
Absolutely. Just because it's a chemical, don't say because it's a bad thing. Food.
Exercise.
Exercise. The most important things for those kind of stressors is the support of other people. It's the support of friends. It's the support of family. It's the support of community. So if you're a member of this congregation, if somebody that's close to you dies, the members of this congregation support you, don't they? The clergy support you. If you're in a workplace and somebody close to you dies, your colleagues support you. We have done that since the dawn of human existence. Human beings are social animals, and we thrive in social groups. They're necessary for us. So social groups are necessary to buffer tolerable stress, and they're also necessary for good health. So study after study after study, looking at long-term health outcomes, shows that the two most important things that we can actually do to improve our health in the long term are, number one, have really good intimate relationships. People who have really good intimate relationships, that is people that you love and care for, and that love and care for you, do way better. And it doesn't matter how much money you make, it doesn't matter where you live, that's really important for all your health, not just mental health, but physical health too. The second thing that we know is really important for positive long-term health is do good things for others. How simple is that? But it's true. The more and more you do for other people, to help other people, family, outside the family, in your community, the healthier you actually become. And when you think about it, those are the two things that happen when you're faced with tolerable stress. Those loss of somebody, loss of your jobs, all that, right? What do you do? You reach out to others. Relationships, and they want to help you. They reach out to you. You get better, and they get better. It's built into our genetic makeup. It's who we are. If I lose my job, I don't need Prozac. I don't need psychotherapy. I need the support of people who care about me, and I need a job. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's what I mean. If I lose someone who I love, I need to be surrounded by people around me who help me grieve. It's normal. It hurts. It takes time. But I get through the other end. Not because of medicines. Not because I go to see a psychologist. No, because the people around me take me through that. Those are normal human experiences. It's become quite fashionable in the last 20, 30 years to medicalize them. To say, oh, you're feeling sad because someone died. You have an illness. No, you don't have an illness. You have something called life. Okay? suck it up. It's necessary. And everybody in this room will have that experience of tolerable stress many times in our lives. Many of us have had already. And we've got through it. Some with scars. Some with bigger scars than others, because not all of us handle these things exactly the same way, but we've made it through. And we use a term to describe that phenomenon. We call it a mental health problem. So what we mean by that is, I don't have a mental illness, and I don't have everyday distress, but I have something in between. So if I have a mental health problem, then I'm dealing with something that I need other people's help with. That's good. It's okay. Some people, about 1 in 5 people in this country, over the course of their lifetime will develop a mental illness. Or a mental disorder. We use the words interchangeably. It's slightly different, but we use them interchangeably. And that means we have an illness like we have diabetes or arthritis or heart disease or cancer or whatever. And for that, we need treatments. So having the support of other people is essential. Because that's who we are as human beings. And having the support of somebody, family, friends, and others, when we have cancer or if we have schizophrenia, or if we have diabetes or if we have depression, it's the same thing. That support is good for us. It's necessary. Human connection is the key to improving the human condition. That's the baseline. But if we have an illness, the support is what we call necessary, but not sufficient. It's, you need it, but by itself, it won't help you overcome what the illness has brought to you. And for that, we need treatments. And there are lots of treatments which are effective. We have good research on them. There are psychological treatments, social supports, medications if necessary. And those are administered the same way you administer any medical treatment. But you only need that if you have the disorder. You don't need that if you have a problem. And you don't need that if you have distress. And one of the challenges that we have is how to link what we call treatments to people who actually need them. Just because I'm feeling upset doesn't mean I go get a pill. Means you go get a bottle of booze.
It usually works.
I would say that. Erase that off.
I'm going to sell it to Seagram's.
All right, give me 10%. So, does that make sense now? And a person can be in all of those states at the same time. They're not mutually exclusive. So, I'll use myself as an example. I actually have a mental illness called attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. I went through school with a seat of honor right next to the teacher. Okay. Where I could be reached by the proven therapeutic intervention of the day. The yardstick. And at least once a week I would go for secondary treatment to the principal's office. That's the way it was. I don't begrudge that. I don't know what it was at that time. My father-in-law died 6 weeks ago. Severe illness, a lot of grief. And today I couldn't find the church. I missed it 5 or 6 times. It's a thing with the cross on it. Okay. It's hard I can say that my father was a Presbyterian minister, so I can get away with all sorts of stuff. It's only fair after all. So that is, that's what the words mean. And you see how those things interact? So you can have a mental illness be being treated for it and be mentally healthy at the same time. That's okay. It's good. Having a mental illness doesn't mean you're sick. Having a mental illness means you have an illness and you can be healthy at the same time concurrently. The same way you can have diabetes and be healthy, the same way you can have HIV/AIDS and be healthy at the same time. And that's what we strive for if we're trying to help someone, treat someone who has a mental illness. We're trying to help them control the illness so that they can be healthy. We don't cure very much. But we try to help people be as healthy as we can. And so the word that you will hear that people use is a word called recovery. That's what the word means. To be as healthy as you can. That's what it means. And we do all sorts of things that try to keep us healthy and make us healthy. All those good things. So when we recognize that, it's really then useful to say, okay, how can we help young people? How can we help ourselves? How can we help our teenagers? How can we help our families navigate those different components? So let's start with the illness. If somebody has a mental illness, they need rapid access to effective care. Both things are necessary. Rapid access is a social justice issue. It's a social justice issue. You have the right, as the citizen of this province, to have equitable access for care for a mental illness the same way you have that access for care for a physical illness. That's your right. And unfortunately, we're not there yet. We have to fight so hard to get it. But that's a justice issue. So the way that we fight that fight is at the ballot box. We all have an MLA. That's where we fight that fight. Okay? The quality of care is a healthcare quality competency issue. So we can't, as citizens, that's not a fight that we can take on. That's the fight that our health authorities have to take on. But we can demand that of them. So we can demand, for example, that when our physicians and our nurses and our psychologists and our counselors, etc., who are paid by our tax dollars, yours and mine, that when they offer us diagnosis and treatments, that they offer the best that is possible. That they offer things that work. That they don't do things that don't work. There's a lot of that. And that they include us as equal partners in the care that's provided. That we can demand. But we have to know that. So all those things come together to be in place if you have a mental disorder. Now, how do you know if you have a mental disorder? Well, one of the confusing things is that the same brain circuits that are involved when we get distress are the same brain circuits that are involved when we have a mental health problem, and are the same brain circuits that are involved when we have a mental illness. So let me explain that a little better, because that's a little bit, does it mean nothing? What that means is, take the feeling of sadness. We feel sad, unhappy, low, down. That sadness feeling is modulated, is created by literally hundreds of thousands of brain circuits, that neurons linked to each other, and they interact with each other. So when I feel a bit sad or a negative emotion, those neurons are doing their thing. And when they're doing it, when we have distress, they're doing it to help me. They're doing it to help me. Okay, pay attention, you got to do something. Okay? tingly, the upset, that's, okay, they're there to help me. When I'm having a mental health problem, because of the magnitude of the environmental stressor, they are trying to help me, but they're being overwhelmed. So they're not working exactly as well as they would be. Think about it as your car, the tires on your car, that's the surface they're going round and round. And when you're on a road that's nice and dry and good, not an HRM because it's full of potholes, but other places, you are just driving along and the tires, the rubber is hitting the road and you go fine, right? That's okay. You hit some potholes, that's distress, you're still doing fine, right? Circuits are doing their thing. You hit a mental health problem, you're stuck in the mud. Circuits are going round and round and round, but you're going to get out of it. A mental illness is when the circuits are really malfunctioning. That's a flat tire. Okay, same circuit, different condition. Does that make sense? So that's why sometimes it gets really confusing when we're talking about mental illness and mental health states and all these things, because it's the same circuits. And our language is really bad for that. So if you say, I feel depressed, do you mean am I having distress? Am I having a mental health problem? Or do I have a mental illness or depression? And we have to be really, really clear with the language. Because if we don't, we get everybody confused. And that's one of the big problems that we are now seeing on all of these surveys that you read about. Because a lot of the kids that are filling out the surveys don't know the difference between feeling normal sadness and unhappiness and having a deep depression of an illness. Because we've taught them depressed. Did you feel depressed in this class exam? In the last 6 months, have you felt depressed? Some of the time? Another time? All of the time. Most kids write some of the time. 80% of kids will write some of the time. That's normal. But the media, 80% of kids in Halifax are depressed some of the time. They never mention some of the time. They don't. The fact that sometimes people get depressed doesn't sound newspaper. Who cares? That's fine. A hoop, shrug. And kids get confused. Kids get confused because if they're taught over and over and over again that their life is supposed to be stress-free, as soon as they start to feel the stress response, wow, it's horrible. And what has occurred, and this is fascinating, what has occurred over decades is that what we call the attribution, what we think about it, has changed. So, you see, it's not just the stress response that's important. It's what we think the response means. And the research on this is relatively new, about 10 years old, but profoundly dismissive of all our understanding of stress in the past. Because we've all been taught stress is bad for you. It turns out that if we think stress is bad for us, it is bad for us. Seriously. In fact, if you want to have some interesting TED Talks, Google Make Stress Your Friend tonight and listen to Carrie McGonigal talk about some of the research on what's called the attributional components of stress. And she nicely points out that if you actually are feeling stress and you think that that stress is bad for you, it increases your risk of death dramatically. But if you feel exactly the same amount of stress and you think it's good for you, it lowers your death rate well below the population norm. In fact, she points out that thinking stress is bad for you is the 15th leading cause of death in the United States. And what are we teaching our kids? That stress is bad. So we got a lot of correcting to do. The
The other thing that happens is that we don't teach kids the difference between the different kinds of stress. How many here have been in situations where people have actually taught you about positive stress? Put your hand. Very small number. And I see the school curriculum not teaching kids about positive stress. You got stress, you got to do a program to dampen the stress of students. You don't. You see, our bodies dampen the stress response naturally. The stress response is called caused by what we call sympathetic overdrive. The sympathetic nervous system does its thing. But our bodies are also built with checks and balances. We get the sympathetic overdrive, and we get the shut-off valve, boom, parasympathetic system. So that works. It's on, off, on, off, on. Everything's on, off, all the time. And it's balanced. It's called homeostasis. It keeps us in balance. So, if we really want to shut down the stress response, we solve the problem that's causing the stress response. It goes away. Bingo, gone. And guess what? Now you have a skill set. Oh, I've learned something. And next time that that happens, I'm going to do the same thing. And I'm going to, great. Think about something that causes stress to a lot of people, like public speaking. First time you do public speaking. If you avoid it, the next time, if you avoid it, you never can do it. But if you handle it, go up and do it, the 20th or 30th time, you won't even notice it. It's called extinction. It's got weight. That's how we're built. That's how we're built. But we're teaching our kids not to do that. You see, this parasympathetic system, we can actually engage it ourselves. If we get into a stress situation where we're feeling the response, and we want to engage the parasympathetic nervous system to shut it down, what's the quickest, simplest, most effective way to engage this parasympathetic system to shut down the stress response?
Breathe.
Hold your breath. Not too long. Just a certain amount of time. Breathe deeply. What that does, it stabilizes the diaphragm, which is innervated by the vagus nerve, which is the nerve that drives the parasympathetic system, and then it slows down your heart rate. And become more calm, shuts down the sympathetic system. There is a very interesting program that we've just reviewed for the Department of Education. They asked us, should we put this program into our schools? And now they're doing some really good things. They're saying, what's the evidence behind this program? Good idea. Should we put in something that doesn't work, or should we put in something in the school that actually does work? What a brilliant new thing. That's great, they're doing it. That's fantastic. That's great. One of my friends, John LeBlanc at the IDFK, is doing all sorts of great work. One of the programs that they asked us to evaluate, guess what it's called? Learn to breathe. You don't need to learn to breathe. We do it on our own. Quite well, most of the time. So you can spend a gazillion dollars on a program that teaches you to breathe, or you can just hold your breath. The choice is yours. It's your tax dollar. And so we got to be really careful with the words, because a lot of the kids now are thinking that if they feel a little bit of stress, wow, the world's going to end. It's chicken little, chicken little, chicken little. We're doing a lot of work now on college campuses, and wow, the problems there. You look back at the generations, because there's data, mostly from the United States, because they've been asking questions in college students for a long time. And question, what makes you feel most anxious? Use the word anxious instead of stressed out. People get that confused. Because anxiety is actually an abnormal state. It's in that illness component. And we just can't settle ourselves down because our brains are so psychotherapy.
that the Vietnam War?
Oh, that's a little bit later.
After.
Nuclear war. Nuclear war is a pretty stressful idea. And it may come back to us very soon. I have this finger on the left side of the house. It's something that really keeps you asleep at night. In the 1960s, now it's your turn. Vietnam War. In the 80s, violence.
The economy?
Violence.
Violence?
Yeah, say violence. Afraid of violence. Afraid of being raped or attacked on campus. And what's the number one thing that causes kids high level of stress on campus today?
Jobs.
Exams. Now, nuclear war, the exams, slightly different pressure. And what has happened is that these expectations of a stress-free life and the message that we have been given to our kids that everything should be just fine has now led them to expect everything should be just fine, but it's not that way. And we have sort of de-skilled them by helicoptering them, snowplowing them, everything else, trying to clear the path from them. Done that as a society, done that in our school system. My oldest grandchild is 6 now. His name is Liam. Great little kid. When he was 3, I spent a lot of time with him because we were very lucky. 3 of our grandkids, all boys, live within 3 kilometers of us, which is really wonderful. And I remember when Liam was 3, he and I spent an entire day together. And his mom and our daughter came and took him. And I was exhausted, just run. And I lay down on the couch, and my wife came home, and she said, what are you doing lying down? I'm bed, so I'm exhausted. I said, I've been looking after Liam. She said, oh, yeah, I'm exhausted. I said, yeah. I do not understand how we raised our kids. And she looked at me, she said, we?
Good for you to feel bad sometimes.
And if you, I've used that line from that famous soliloquy a couple of times, from Hamlet, it says, suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. And what's the next part of that phrase? And by so doing, end them. Shakespeare's completely right. You want to deal with stress? You suffer it, and it ends. But that's not the message we're teaching our kids. We're teaching them, don't suffer anything. It doesn't help. And so what now happens is it becomes much more difficult to differentiate where that line is. Where that line is of, this is me, I can't handle the normal slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. I need to go see a doctor, I need to go get medicine, I need to go get this, I need to go get that. So we as a society have to start cutting some of that back. The problem that we have is that a lot of kids have grown up with that. So how do you cut back for them? It's a challenge. We're working it out on the college campuses, and it's a problem. And I'm a prophet now. So exams are stressful. They're supposed to be. The stress of failing exams is supposed to teach you to do something. It's called study. That's what it's for. That's what the stress is for. But we're getting all sorts of kids who've never studied, and now all of a sudden they got an exam and they can't handle it. So what does the university do? Well, what they should do is, as you come in right into the beginning of first year, is to start teaching you study skills and telling you that when you feel stressed around exams, that's normal, and here are the skills that you need to help yourself be successful. That's what they should be doing. What do? They create petting zoos, puppies. That's right, exam. I'm anxious. Go pet a puppy. Well, a puppy is not likely to write the exam for you. Unless it's a poodle, in which case probably smarter than you are. And I'll tell you, if I'm a surgeon in the operating room, I don't want that medical student coming in with a puppy. It's funny what I say, but when you actually think about it and you talk to people, oh, this is wonderful, we got puppies. Well, what about studying? What about studying? What happens here is kids who are naturally go-getters and just blaze ahead on their own become more successful, and the rest of us fall by the wayside. So this kind of social process creates a wider gulf between people who are successful because they just have it in them, that their genes just go and do this stuff, and people who are like the rest of us, who are sort of more socially nuanced. And that's a real challenge, because that's not good for a society to have those kind of very big divisions. It's not good for a society to have huge divisions in wealth. It's not right for our society, not even not good, it's not right for our society to have huge divisions in opportunity. It's not right. It's not right for our society to discriminate discriminations. It's just not right. And yet that's what we're doing in our schools and in our communities by creating this differentiation for kids. It's not good for them. And that gets in the way of all these things is when is it bad enough that you think it's a mental illness? Well, when the symptoms, the things that the child is feeling, the negative things, the thinking, the behaviors, the social interactions, when they become problematic, way different than normal, and they persist for long periods of time, that's the key. It's way different than usual, and it persists for long periods of time. It's normal to feel unhappy or sad for days, weeks, even a month. But when it's there for 6 months, and it's there constantly, and it's there all the time, that's a problem. When it's a change from your original state of being, okay? Someone who is laid back and pleasant and happy, all of a sudden, not, that's not there, it's gone away. And much of this happens by itself without any particular stimulus from the environment. The other thing that you need to know is you need to know your family history, because mental disorders run in families. So ADHD runs in my family. Most of my male relatives died in World War II, so I don't know them. But I do know my kids, our oldest, boom, ADHD, no question about it. He took the extra lap in primary school, took the extra lap in secondary school, took the extra lap in university, did fine, his lawyer's doing good. His oldest son, ADHD, clearly. You can just see the genetic line. Oh, gee, you got that comp gene. I can tell. I got D4 illegal. I can tell. Boom, 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 boom. So you got to know the family history. You got to know what runs in your family. So if the child, if your child or your teenager, you got to know this stuff. You know if heart disease is in your family, don't you? You know if diabetes is in your family. You know that. You know if breast cancer is in your family. You got to know what mental disorders, if any, are in your family. And the window for when mental disorders, the illnesses onset, is between ages 13 and 25. 70% of all mental illnesses can be diagnosed before age 25. 70%. But our whole system is set up not to do that. Our whole system is set up to let's wait until people have been sick for a long time and then we'll help them. It's just back asswards. It's just not the way it's supposed to be. One of my brothers is a gastroenterologist, and he works at the wrong end of the body, but you know. But he laughs and he says, in his field, we want to catch bowel cancer in stage one. Why? Because if they catch it in stage one, 95% of the time, we can get rid of it for you. He says, in your field, you wait till people are in stage four, and then you offer them treatment. That's just not the right thing to do. That's a social justice problem. Right? We can do that. We can actually put a health clinic in every single junior high and high school in this room. We can do that. And the education system has solved the problem of access. Why? Because that's where the kids are. They're there. Not every kid, but most kids are there. You want to have, you want kids to be as healthy as they can, right? If the kids are already there, why not put the clinic in the school? Health for all, just down the hall. It's very simple. I like making up those kind of things. It gets across. And the kids can go and see the nurse and see the doctor. Why isn't the GP in every single high school and high school? Why? Why aren't pediatricians in all the primary schools? That's where the kids are. No, we send the kids to school and then they have to go home and then have to go down to the clinic and the clinic's closed because they want to go to 4:30. This is nonsense. We know how to fix it, we're just not doing it. It's not rocket science. You know, I'm not that smart. But these are the kind of structural problems that we have and we need you to help us try and fix those things. So kids will respond to these different kind of levels of stressors in different ways. And one of the ways that people talked about was cutting. And cutting is not an illness, cutting is a behavior. And as a behavior, it is very, very sensitive to a phenomenon we call contagion. If people are doing it, I'm gonna do it. Every behavior is like that. If everybody walked like this, you walk like that. If everybody wears clothing of a particular kind, you wear clothing of that particular kind. It's behavior, because we fit in with those around us. So if your friends are cutting, you tend to cut. And cutting is a very, very complex issue. Very complex. So cutting can be a behavior that is a sign of having a mental illness. It can. So sometimes kids who are having really difficulty regulating their moods, will cut as a way of trying to help themselves regulate the mood. Right? It's not a very effective way. It can bring temporary relief. But a youngster who is cutting because that's the challenge that they're dealing with, they're in that top part of that group of pyramid, they have a mental disorder and they need treatment. But cutting can also become a contagion behavior, and it can become what's called a learned behavior. I cut to relieve anxiety. I cut to relieve stress. I cut to relieve sadness. I cut to relieve this. And once you learn to do that, you do it. Once you learn that having a scotch relieves your anxiety at the end of the day, you do it. Because having a scotch and cutting are both relief mechanisms of a different magnitude. The thing is with cutting is that the cutting can actually release chemicals in the brain that make you feel better. So it can become a self-perpetuating phenomenon. And then if it gets to that, there are treatments that actually do help, psychological and sometimes medical. Or cutting can be part of a social gestalt. What I mean by that is a way of social interaction which is now much more permissible and much more common. It can be that too. It can be all those different things. And the key is that cutting often starts out as a way to solve a problem. I got a problem, my friends have done this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it as a way to solve the problem. It's just not a very good way of solving the problem. So if kids are having the challenge of cutting, it's really important to figure out, is this a symptom or a sign that they may be having a mental disorder, therefore need treatment? Is this a sign that they have a problem that they need to solve, they're using this technique, but the technique is not a good one, and so can we help them learn a different way to solve that problem? Is the cutting a way of feeling part of a group or being welcomed in, and it's a ritual of passage kind of thing? Could be that too. All right, so the important thing is to figure out for each kid that is cutting, what is the purpose of the cutting? And then once you figure that out, how can I help you choose something which is more useful and which will help you solve the problems that you're trying to address? And sometimes it takes a mental health assessment to be able to figure that out. Sometimes a GP can do that. Sometimes it's too complicated. Sometimes you sit down with your child and have that chat and that discussion and see what can happen. All right? So cutting is a behavior, not an illness. It can be a harbinger of an illness, but can also be a good example of bad problem solving. All of us come to solve problems with techniques that are good and techniques that aren't so good. So if cutting is a problem-solving technique, the approach is to substitute a technique which is better than the technique which is not. Now, I'm aware of the time, so I want to touch on the issue of suicide because that was raised and it was something we were going to talk about. It's a very difficult topic. Has tremendous emotional components. And that emotionality is both good because it sensitizes us to the importance of the topic. The it's also not so good. Because it often leads us to make decisions about how to deal with the issue from our emotions instead of our cognition. Now, suicide is taking one's own life on purpose. That's what it means. We used to use the phrase commit suicide. I don't use that phrase anymore because it has a connotation, a legal component. I don't use that phrase. We say die by suicide or attempt suicide. And it is deliberate self-harm in order to die. It's very different than cutting. Cutting is deliberate self-harm, not with the intent of dying, intent of solving a problem or something else. But a suicide attempt is, I did something because I wanted to die, and I thought that if I did this, I would die. Now, suicide then is again not a disorder, it is a behavior. Remember what I said about behaviors? They can be contagious. Same with suicide, it's a behavior. So, and particularly in young people. So that's where we get contagion suicide, cluster suicide. It doesn't happen when we get older. The highest group, the group at most at risk for dying by suicide in our province, in our country, are people your age, or my age, between the ages of 40 and 60, I'm a little older than that. That's the highest risk group. Young people are half the risk. So, and suicide is a rare phenomenon. The rate in Nova Scotia is about 10 per 100,000. We just hear about almost everyone. That's why it seems like it's everyone. 10 per 100,000. The rate of schizophrenia in the province is 1 in 100. Okay? So that's tells you a little bit about where the suicide comes in. Most people who die by suicide have a mental illness. A mental illness. The most common illness associated with suicide is depression. And the risk for a person who has depression is about 5%. That means 5% of people who have a depressive illness will die by suicide. For people who have schizophrenia, it's 10 to 15%. Bipolar disorder, 10 to 15%. Alcohol abuse, 10%. Now, when you say 10 to 15% for a particular mental disorder, that's percent compared to 10 per 100,000 in the general population. And remember, that 10 per 100,000 in the general population includes people with illnesses. It's pretty obvious that what we want to address the issue of suicide, the way that we do that is through early identification and effective treatment for people with mental disorder. That's how it works. And that, when we do that, the data shows us that we actually can make a good impact on that. We can do that. But again, needs investment in mostly primary health care. Because most people who are to the point that they consider that living is not an option will visit their family physician, who are very bad at picking this up. Very bad at picking this up. So the way that we really, if we want to decrease the rate, the number of people who die by suicide, it is to actually improve access to care, identification of people who have a mental disorder, rapid access to effective treatment. That's the thing. It's the same challenge we have for mental health peer care. The same challenge. The best programs in the world that have shown the best impact on reducing suicide rates are not community-based programs. They have very little, if any, impact. The programs are improving the quality of care and improving access. So those are the kinds of things we should be looking for. For young people, the more it's a difficult area. you want to open the door so that if a young person is feeling suicidal or feeling that life isn't worth living, you want to open the door so that they feel free to talk about it to you, to a trusted adult. You want to have that door be open if you're a parent, if you're a teacher. That's why it's so important to do the mental health in the schools. Because a lot of kids will talk to their teachers. Now our province is starting to put these programs into the schools. Good, so the teachers know. Right? Helping kids know that that's where they can go to a trusted adult, teacher, a coach, pastor, parent, friend's parent, that often is helpful. That's really important. That's very different than everyone standing up on top of a podium and saying, I felt suicidal yesterday. That doesn't help. That actually makes it worse. Because it normalizes it. Okay, all the time is everybody talk about it. Just talking about it isn't the answer. It actually can make things worse. But having a kid know that speaking to a trusted adult who then will listen and provide that hand of support when that child needs it, that's good. That's good. So we are starting to do some of that in this province, is helping teachers, coaches, counselors, parents learn how to listen when their kids are talking. And with a teenager, it is very, very different than with younger children. With younger children, a parent controls the social interaction in a major way. With a teenager, you don't. You don't. And the thing is that when the teen needs to talk to you, it's usually at a very inopportune time, like 2 a.m. But that's the time that they need you. So parenting a teen is very different than parenting a 12-year-old or a 10-year-old or a 6-year-old. Very, very different. And it's really essential that when your kids are young, that you start to open up those lines of communication so that they feel that they can talk to you when they need to. Alright? Now, not all kids are the same. Some kids, out it comes. I shut the valve off. Other kids don't want to say squat. They're much more private individuals. It's very hard if you have a private child and a parent who wants to know. That's a difficult dynamic. It's a very difficult dynamic. And sometimes if you have that dynamic in a family, it's really important to get a third party to help out. It's really important because sometimes the child will tell a third party, or the third party can help the child and the parent learn that the other person needs to know, has a right to know, and wants to know. That doesn't mean to tell everything. God, no. But the important things. One of the challenges of being a parent around that is that you want to keep an open mind. But not so far open that your brains fall out. There are rules, there are limits, they have to be clear. In our home, we had very, very few rules. Because we believed the more rules you make, the more rules that can be broken. But the rules that we had were non-negotiable. And they had very clear consequences. Few rules around the important stuff. Not around your homework. You don't do your homework. You don't do well at school. That's your problem. Not about your hair. Who cares? Okay? Hair today, gone tomorrow. safety is important. You don't get into a car if someone's been smoking dope or has been drinking. And you damn well don't drive yourself if you've been doing that. That's a clear-cut rule. You break that, you're grounded out. I mean, you're grounded, not for a day or two weeks. Give you a lot of time to think about how I should have done that. Very few rules, very clear. And also remember that part of the beautiful things about adolescence is it's the time of life when you are actually more free to experiment than any other time of life. That's one of the great things about adolescence. All the really neat discoveries of our societies, all the amazing journeys that we've made around the world have never been made by 65-year-old men like me. They've been made by 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, 20-year-olds. Right? So it's a really important, vibrant, incredible part of life. It's also challenging. And because part of adolescence is learning how to live in complex social circumstances. It's the most difficult thing we learn is how to navigate this incredible complex society. And they're going to get it wrong more times than they get it right because you learn by getting it wrong. I should have done that. I wanted to try it 16 more times before. It's also part of the thing. Part of the thing. So, I'm just going to end up this evening by sharing a story of one of our kids when they were 16. And because it illustrates the normative part of growing up. So we had recently moved here, and I took on the job as head of psychiatry at Dalhousie. And we had rented a home in Halifax, and one day I was looking for a shirt of mine that I had seen our oldest son wear. And you know, the ultimate form of flattery is when your kids are wearing your clothes. They won't tell you that, the kids actually want to be a little bit like you. Not totally, a little bit. And I sort of wanted that shirt, so I thought, oh, I don't know where I got this idea, but it'll actually be in his room. So I went up to his room, and he had removed all the light bulbs in the room. And his method of stowing his clothes was on the floor, right next to the watch 6 months ago or whatever. In fact, my wife had a great strategy for dealing with that. She would say to all the kids, she would say, I want you to clean your room up. You know, never done. Then she figured out, you know what, it seems like you need help cleaning your room up. I'm going to go in and help you. No! How long do you think before it's done? Right away! Works every time. So I went into the room to get my shirt, and everything was dark, but I noticed there was a light on in the closet. Great closet lights, you know. Great. So I thought, well, the shirt's hanging in the closet. I went in the closet, I opened the door, and I found his botany experiment. There were a number of tall green plants. Which I immediately recognized because I'd seen pictures of them when I was in college. So I liberated them from their closet home and brought them, put them on the kitchen table. It's time to have the talk about these plants. And so Dan rolled home, and he was very, very surprised to see his pride and joy on the kitchen table. So we had to talk. These are drugs. They're illegal.
if you're living on your own and you choose to use these drugs, that's your business. These are the pros and cons of this. We need to talk about it. You can't have them in this home. What would people say if the media found out that the chief of psychiatry better grow up? So I told him, go throw them on the compost, and she didn't. Do you have any idea how well those plants grow on compost? We're the most popular home in that whole part of Halifax. And then one day, they mysteriously disappeared. No idea where they went. So there you are. I've seen someone who's having a little bit of a problem, or maybe I can help out there if necessary. Otherwise, I'm just going to say thank you so much for your time. And there are some brochures and things that you can look at. You're